a lot for coming in, sitting in on this session. I hope WordCamp has been enjoyable so far and instructive, and you've met people and made some relationships, and that's really what it's all about. So that's awesome. I wasn't planning on doing a talk at all, and then we had a couple of really cool experiences with my company, which I'll talk to you about, and I thought, I've got to share this with people, because I think we're onto something really cool. And so I crafted a talk, and then it wasn't really hard getting the talk in, because I'm responsible for all the curriculum and all the talks. So I just kind of said, hey, Tom, and I'm like, oh, I don't know, buddy. I don't even know who you are. I'm like, come on, I'll get you ice cream. I'm like, oh, ice cream. So it was pretty easy. And then I was like, can I have 2 hours? I'm like, sure, for you, buddy. So yeah, this is the only 2-hour talk, and the reason for that is not because I want to dominate your time, but I want to do a workshop. I have no idea how this is going to go. This is entirely experimental, but I'm going to do a regular presentation first, and then, assuming you haven't left by that point, I want to show you how this usage modeling process actually unfolds, because it's the kind of thing you have to see, you have to experience, and you got to do. My objective is to hopefully not only teach you about some stuff about project scoping and how to figure out, you know, for yourself or for your clients what goes into a project, but hopefully to help you get on the way to facilitating this process for others, right? And you take what you want out of it. You take what you can out of it. You'll either be running workshops with, 20 stakeholders, or you'll just be doing this on the phone with a customer, or you'll just be applying these principles as you see fit. So take what you can, take what you feel that participating in more of a workshop-like session can be instructive, and we'll just see how it goes. And I'll talk more about why we could have some challenges with that a little bit later on when I tell you a bit more about what it is that we're doing. So first of all, a quick about me. Tom Auger, I'm one of the senior partners at a downtown digital agency called Zeitguys. We're downtown Toronto. We do web apps, we do iOS apps, and iPhone apps, and we do a lot of WordPress sites. I have contributed to the WordPress core project in the past, and you've probably known me from the meetup groups, and this is my fourth WordCamp that I've co-organized with great people like Greg and Brent and Andy and Dayon and all those, and Shanta. So I'm deeply part of the WordPress community, but this is not a WordPress talk at all. So if you need to leave, I won't be offended. Okay, cool. This is really a general, this track that we created is an agency track, and it's at freelancers and people that are running small agencies and people that are running big agencies, people that are in the biz, that are either doing stuff for themselves or doing stuff for customers. And if you, this particular talk is also targeted at people that have their own projects. Maybe you're in a marketing agency, maybe you're in a marketing department of a company, and you guys have a web project coming up. Maybe you have a personal blog and you're just trying to figure out, what should I do? Maybe I need to talk to a developer. What sorts of things should I include? Or maybe you're like me and you have clients and you do this for clients, and often you run into situations where clients don't really know what they want, and hopefully this tool is going to help you get there. All right, so that's about me. I'm going to be running back and forth because I didn't think to bring a clicker. Oh, only just a quick notes about the presentation. I'm a developer, so I'm really geeky this way. This is a JavaScript that's running this presentation, not PowerPoint. A little tool called remark.js, which takes Markdown and turns it into this really simple, nice presentation. So unlike anybody else, my slides are on GitHub. If you don't know what any of that means, don't worry about it. All that means is you can go to github.com, or you can just not have a computer that works at all. All right, never mind. Anyway, you can go to github.com, you can click on the link, and you'll have the whole thing in Markdown, which is kind of like text only. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what this talk is supposed to be all about. Usage modeling comes to us from software design. Actually, before any of that, how many of you are from agencies? Let's just see some hands. Okay, how many of you are freelancers or do web work for other people? All right, and how many of you are more internal and have web projects that you do either for your company? Okay. Good. That covers pretty. Is there anybody that didn't other than Bernie who teaches this stuff? All right, good. So usage modeling comes to us from software design. It's a way for information architects to help come up with what's called the MVP, which is not the most valuable player, it's the minimum viable product, which is an important concept in software because what happens is whoever's idea is to create the software comes to you and says, we want this software, and it's got to do this, and it's got to do that, and it's got to solve world hunger, and it's got to do all this stuff. And as a developer, you're like, okay, when do you want it? Well, we want it sometime next week. And you're like, well, I can't give you everything. So what do I have to give you? What's the minimum viable product I can give you that will allow you to move forward, to market it, to sell it, to do whatever you have to do while we iterate and then continue to develop forward? So this is an exercise that information architects do. And I learned this from an information architect who sort of ran me through the process. And we don't do a lot of software development at Zeitguise. We do, you know, stuff that you guys do. We do websites and apps and things like that. But a lot of the concepts are the same. I want a Google Maps API so I can do all kinds of cool stuff. And you're like, okay, but how much do you really need? Well, first of all, how much money have you got? How much time have you got? And, you know, how much of this do you really need to get going to do what you want to do? So usage modeling maps business, this is like dense stuff, right? Maps business objects, taxonomies, and key interactions to user scenarios. Now, did anyone know what that means? Because I'm not sure I do. What it means is that it takes, well, you'll see, actually. I don't need to explain that. I just put that really cool looking sentence up there to make me feel good, but this whole talk is about helping you understand what that is. So the usage modeling workshop is a workshop that gathers all the stakeholders of a company together. Well, all the stakeholders that are involved in the project. So let's say I'm interviewing a client and we're doing this process. I'm going to obviously have their marketing department. If they're operations based, you know, depending on the nature of the company, maybe some people from ops are going to be there. You can get some of their customers involved. Anybody who has a different perspective on the project, the more viewpoints and angles you can get on something, the more valuable it's going to be. The more rich the input is going to be, and therefore the more insightful the output is going to be, right? You're going to get different perspectives. Because if all you have is the director of marketing and the marketing manager sitting in the room, they're probably just going to talk about, you know, a very thin slice, right? And then they're going to nod their head for all the rest. And so for me, the best sessions that I've facilitated where there's been active discussion, let alone, you know, verbal abuse. Never got to fist fights yet, but, you know, that would be a really cool thing to, you know, have to break that apart, of course, but that'd be really cool to see because that tension derives insight if you don't kill each other, right? And so that's definitely something, you know, if you're running one of these things or if you're interviewing a client, try to bring different viewpoints together. So it brings stakeholders together, and as a result, because we have these different viewpoints, it captures the edge requirements. Anyone know what I mean by an edge requirement? Anyone? Okay. So you could probably guess what an edge requirement means because you've heard of edge use cases and living on the edge and all that kind of stuff. So a client comes to you or your team leader says, we got to do this website, we got to do this project, and we need this, 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 and this. We need a contact form, and we need a landing page, and we need Google Analytics, and we need some SEO and all that, right? The typical laundry list of requirements that pretty much every website you've ever worked on has. And so it's like, duh, yeah. What I'm interested in is those really weird requirements that we didn't know about. Is there a customer portal? Do you have a certain user group that you're catering to? What about people that are looking for a job? Do you ever think about that part of the website? Kinds of edge requirements that aren't necessarily listed when they called you up and said, this is what we need, or you're responding to a RFP that might not be in there. And this kind of workshop brings that out because it's a cross-functional workshop. It brings different people together. And so the edge requirements come out. It's a usage modeling workshop, so the key is usage, and the key agent of usage is the user. And this is a user-centric approach. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about user-centric in a second, but one of the main deliverables of this activity is identifying the user groups, all of the different people that are going to interact with the project, right? And again, the client marketing might be thinking, oh, we're going to sell to our customers, okay? And maybe you're selling to a thin slice, and that's just that one people that like leather knee-high boots, and that's all we're selling, and those are those people, and that's it. But is that really all your website's for? You know, what about your competition? You got to consider that. What about the media? What about your own staff? You know, what about your salespeople? What about internal? What about your marketing team? These are all actors within the scope of the project that if you don't consider them, someone's going to be left out. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that when you finally hone it out and you get the MVP, the minimum viable product, that you might have to sort of let some of the users go until next round. Okay, we're not going to build that customer portal yet. Or we're not going to optimize the WP admin backend to make it easy for marketing to update stuff on the fly and do campaigns or whatever. That's phase two, phase three. Identified it, we've recorded it, we've documented it, and that's what this thing is. This is a facilitation tool that can kickstart and launch a project well into phase two, three, four. It's a roadmap, okay? And it documents interaction patterns, and that's ultimately what we're going to talk about. So let's just move on. So I'm going to teach you a bunch of things, or I'm going to explain a bunch of things, and hopefully you'll get some value out of it. But at the end of the day, this is meant to be a practice, okay? It's not meant to be a checklist that you can pass to your client. I've tried this. I've tried doing surveys or doing like checklists and do it over the phone with the customers, like, oh yeah, these things here are, you know, and sort of try to distill this stuff down to a really lean methodology. It doesn't work. The magic of the usage modeling process is the workshop. It's that face-to-face interaction, it's the body language. It's really, really hard even to do it via video conference. It can be pulled off. I have tried where we've run out of time and I've given the client the rest of the workshop to do. I'm like, I've shown you how to do it, now off you go. And it fails every time. You need the facilitator to pull stuff out. And I'll talk about what the roles of the facilitator are. See that you, as a facilitator, add tremendous value. Not just in the technique of how you deliver this stuff, but also that you have a unique perspective. You're from the outside. You're going to ask the dumb questions that everybody took for granted, and you're going to expose the edge cases that people aren't thinking about because you're coming in from the outside. You can't cut out the facilitator from this process. You must generate artifacts.
I don't get a new question.
Sure, absolutely. You've got lots of time. Where is it? I'll get to it.
Okay, all right.
I'll get to it because that's actually an interesting question. So hopefully it's not out of sequence the way I did it, but we'll get there. So must be facilitated. We want to generate artifacts, which is cool because like I really like Indiana Jones. Artifacts are awesome. In information architecture and user experience design, an artifact is any output from a meeting. So these are often done with post-it notes. So you want to generate those artifacts. You're going to have a whiteboard. You're going to write things on the whiteboard. You document it, and it's done, right? So you definitely want to generate as many artifacts as possible. The more physical the artifacts, the more interesting it becomes, right? There's something called saturation. Anybody know about the concept of saturation when you're working on a project? You take, you get a war room, and you fill that with like photos and think about the FBI and they're doing a manhunt, and they got, you know, this wall with photos and stuff. That's called saturation, and the idea is you're just like anybody that's in that room is just like surrounded, and insights happen inside the brain because of that physical connection to things that you wouldn't normally have if you're just looking at an spreadsheet or a document on paper. So we want to saturate the environment as much as possible. I'm not going to do that today in this workshop because I didn't bring stuff. I guess organizing a conference made me a little distracted. So we're just going to do markers on the whiteboard. But generally, you want to work with props. You want to have stickers that get people up and moving and sticking stuff on things. And that's going to help sort of create physical connections. And then you're going to leave you with some really interesting artifacts. And the client sometimes likes to keep them. And they put them in their war room. And that becomes their kind of go-to thing, you know. I don't know if you guys find this, but one of the biggest problems with any web project we ever get into is the client's buy-in, their client's enthusiasm. It kind of wanes after a while, right? They're all gung-ho at first, and then they realize, oh crap, I gotta write content? Well, I got a sales thing over here, and I got a conference over here. I don't have time to write content, and it just gets really, really bogged down. One way to help the client is to give them artifacts, saturate them. They walk by that room, and they see stuff on the wall, and they're just thinking about it. And it's sort of, it's eating at them, and they're remembering, they got to do this stuff. So we have to generate artifacts. The most amazing insight, if you take anything out of this, is quantify the outcomes. I'm going to show you how unbelievably powerful quantification is, because a client can tell you all about requirements, and you can talk about color palettes, and you can talk about branding, but when you have to put a number to something, you say, as a facility, you say, okay, so is that 5% or 10% of X? And then they fight about it, and then the discussion happens. And when you quantify things, it generates discussion, and it helps you also later on do some pretty funky calculations that I'm going to show you you can do with this data that then helps you generate some interesting results. In essence, a user scenario is a story told from the perspective of the user. A requirement is the customer saying, I need a contact us form. That's a physical requirement. Well, is the contact us form the only way they can contact you? Well, no, we could do chat, we could do, and all of a sudden you realize, so maybe there's another way of accomplishing your goal. If you tell me you want a contact form, I'm gonna quote on a contact form, I'm gonna build you a contact form, but are we missing an opportunity here? Is there maybe a better way for specific to your user story or your user scenarios that we should be thinking about and scoping as part of the project? So this process can uncover the real truth behind the requirements and the requirements behind the requirements. You know, we talked about the focus on the end users because typically marketing-driven stuff focus on the sales requirements quite often, right? It focuses on the internal sort of agency requirements, but this focuses on the end user by its very definition, by its very nature. The user scenario is, I need a way to get a hold of the company. And then we can break that down even further. So I need a way to get a hold of sales. I need a way to get a hold of support. I need a way to find out what your pricing is. So we take it in terms of user scenarios, and all of a sudden, we uncover a bunch of functional requirements or business requirements. I already talked about quantification that yields surprising insights, and I'm going to show you how that works. And this dense statement that I just came up with in the lunchroom, cross-product creates weighted requirements. The entire objective of this is to, at the end of the day, end up with, well, let me show you. Now, this is a really, really, really big spreadsheet. And what we have here is all of the user stories. So these are all, this is the language of a user-centric approach that hints at functionality. The programmers and the developers in the room are thinking, okay, yeah, I can see Google Maps here, this and that, and I can see taxonomies in WordPress, and that's great. That's how we'll implement it, but let's get at the user stories first. Let's get at the user requirements first. We get all that, and then I'll scroll over here, because the good stuff is over here. So the next thing we do is we find out who is your audience, all right? We got the public, we have innovators, we have the Canadian government, we've got other government health organizations and so forth. And we prioritize all that. And then over here, we get your project objectives. We take all that and then we come up with a score. And that describes how important these things are. So look, learn about summer student opportunities. Turns out, it's got a score of 10 compared to consume content in French and English, which has a score of 100. So that gives us some profound insights into A, how much money should we spend on each of these two tasks? And B, how much effort should we spend on it? And what portion of the budget, what portion of the project scope allocated to these things? And ultimately, what makes the cut? And this is in red, so it didn't make the cut. Okay, this particular thing, learn about opportunities for students. So which audience does that satisfy? Students, right? And when I asked you about students, what percentage of importance did you give to students compared to the Canadian government? Canadian government was 50% because that's their biggest client. Students was like 5%. So it's a really small user group. We take that 5% and then you multiply it by how many project goals does this item address? And it really only addressed one of the many project goals, which was probably, I don't know, course or something like recruitment or something. And so as a result, you get a low score on the user groups, you get a low score on your project objectives, you multiply that out, that gives you a low score on the scenario. So now all of a sudden, we have some profound insights that are backed up by numbers that you can go back to the customer, and they were like, we need the summer students. We need to have a section. We've always had a section on our site about summer students. Why would you want to remove that? I'm like, well, I don't want to remove it. You want to remove it. You told me I do yell, don't I? And I'm just getting louder. I don't want to remove it. You want to remove it. You told me all this stuff. Is this right? They're like, yeah, that's right. Well, then the numbers don't lie. And you told me what your budget was. They're like, okay, well, let's say hypothetically that we had $40,000 to spend. This is the cool part. Let's say we had spend. I'm like, okay, let me type 40,000 here. How much money should I spend on bilingual? About $1,200. How much money should I spend on the summer students? $8. All right, that's basically put them in an Uber and send them somewhere else. isn't that interesting? So this is now me telling the client, look, when you write your RFP, if you need to mention the summer students, mention in the RFP, but don't make it a big bullet item, a big item with its own headline. It's a little bullet at the bottom of the RFP. Whereas you're going to spend, $1,200 on French English translation. Is that reasonable? Okay. A little, not the translation. I mean, like the that kind of stuff. Setting up multi-site. Did you recommend multi-site? It wasn't in your talk. Okay, setting up multi-site and all that kind of stuff. So, and I'm thinking, yeah, that's reasonable, right? Like I could do get French English, not the translation, obviously, but I could do a French English site for that much. And so then I can tell them, well, look, make sure in the RFP that you say, okay, I want to use multi-site. I want to do this. I want you to be able to enter in the English and then switch to the French and make sure that the French and the English is, you've got a translation for every page and the parallelism and all that kind of stuff, right? And so by giving them that, because if this were $200, I'd say, oh boy, désolé. You're not getting your French. I don't know what, right? And here's the cool part. Let's see if I can do this. Customer's like, no, I don't have $40,000. Yeah. Right? I guess it sorted it differently here, but, because where's my French? See that? Ooh. Right, the power of Excel, folks. Forget WordPress. I'm building your site in Excel. But, right, so all of a sudden it's like, okay, so is $25,000 a reasonable budget for you then, given like that you want to do good translation and X and Y and all the other things? Let's take a look at all these things. And can I give you a responsive design with ergonomic functionality for $11? I don't know if I can, right? So I'm like, if that's your budget, we're going to have to trim some more stuff off of here and figure that out. So pretty powerful stuff. And why can I do this? Not because I'm an Excel genius, but I'm not going to deny that I'm an Excel genius, but because quantification yields surprising insights, and it allows you to do stuff. It allows you to do some math and back it up. So I go to the customer and say, this is what you said. And we can tweak it. Because it says $1,138, doesn't mean that's what you got to put in the budget. But it gives you a range, right? This is all very fluid, but at least we have some numbers to put against stuff. So that's what the cross-product creates weighted requirements is all about. The cross-product is multiplying these different things together. Do I really need to sell the value of end-user focus to you guys? I think we understand. UX is like a big buzzword for the last couple of years, and so it's pretty self-evident what user experience is all about. And when you start the project from a user perspective, you're going to have a better user experience than if you start the project from your business's agenda. It's just a natural kind of course. So that value is pretty self-evident. Also, if you put the user first, you've got to think about a wider variety of end users. Like the one end user that's always forgotten is the poor schmuck in marketing who's got to maintain the website, right? And this is the funny part. This is why you're all here with a WordPress, because you believe in the WordPress promise that WordPress makes your life easier. We're going to build you a site on WordPress because it's now a content management system, not a blog, right? And because that'll allow you to did awesome websites. How many of you have had clients that have completely screwed up your beautiful design because of WordPress? Yes, yes, that's right. So the admin is a user, and we need to consider them and potentially build tools that are going to help them do their job and not break your beautiful design, your beautiful bespoke design. Because we don't use themes, do we? Okay. I made up a word. Denombrilization. What do you suppose denombril? Why? Companies tend to be looking at their own belly buttons all the time. They're like, this is what I understand.
That kind of complicated website in the summer system. Could you do it in WordPress?
Absolutely. We do. Every single website we do is done. Mind blown. I didn't know WordPress could do that. Time Magazine's website is on WordPress. Warner Brothers is on WordPress, right? Sobeys is on WordPress.
National Post.
National Post. Come on, other names that we know. Who's on VIP? Ottawa Citizen. Huge websites are on WordPress.
Database driven.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. So WordPress is like, it can do it all, right? The cool word. But basically, what I want to do is I want to pivot an organization's approach to scoping a project, to thinking about a project. From these are our requirements, and hopefully they will touch on the user's requirements. And I'm like, let's pivot that. Let's start with the user's requirements and then figure out how they map to your requirements. We don't want to forget. I was having a call with the customer last week, and I was talking about getting started with this. And the CMO, I'd never even heard of a CMO, the chief marketing officer. The CMO is like, okay, but don't forget, we got priorities and we got to meet our marketing objectives and our marketing targets. I'm like, dude, no worries. We are going to get there. But we're starting pivoted. We're starting from the user's perspective. We'll make sure, like, I have no worry that your priorities, you're going to make sure you get what you want. That's a given. I'm going to give the user a fighting chance by starting from their perspective. We're talking about user scenarios versus business requirements. And sometimes they map, sometimes they don't. So think of contact us. The business says, we need a way for our clients to contact us. That's a business requirement. That's what the marketing manager wants. The user is going to say, I need a way to contact this vendor. That's their user story. That maps beautifully. Perfect. Well, we'll build you a contact something, right? On the other hand, sometimes they don't map. And what most of their users, and Google Analytics bears this out, what most of their users want to do is, I got old books that I've read, and I want to give them to the library. And the library, I don't want your books! So the user scenario is, I want to donate my books. The marketing agenda is, we want your money. So now there's an interesting insight at that intersection. Right? Because now we sit there and we go, okay, somebody's coming into the state books. We have to let them do that. We have to let them do that. We can't let down the user promise. But you want them to give money. So let's make sure that they got to click two or three times before they find out where to donate books. And while they're reading, they're clicking to find out where to donate books, we are bombarding them with all the cool stuff the library does. And by the way, we need your money. And donate now. Right? So we're going to give the user what he wants. We're going to give the marketing initiative what they want, and at the intersection of those, we have a very interesting opportunity to be creative and to do stuff. The windy path, right? Quantification, as I said, if you take anything out of this talk, quantification is what it's all about, man. So customers can give you all kinds of requirements, or you can say, and we'll do this together, you know, what are your user groups? Well, we got these guys and those guys. And everybody's all cool with that. And it's just a bunch of throwing spaghetti on the wall and seeing what sticks. Then it's time for the customer, your customer, the person involved in this, to do the work. You're like, okay. So you've told me that the government of Canada is important to you, and you've told me that the Canadian public is important. What part of the project will we spend more on? How much more important is the government of Canada to the Canadian public, to you as marketing? And they'll be like, well, you know, 50-50. I'm like, okay, really? Like, let's talk about this. They're exactly equal. We can't do equal, so you have to choose one. And then the debate begins. Well, no, the government, man, because they're the people that fund us. The government gives us billions of dollars a year to do this stuff, we've got to make sure that the website's targeted at the government. And then the other side of the table is like, no, it's the Canadian public. They're voting for the government. And I'm, as a designer, thinking they're going, you better make up your mind, because if I'm building a website for the Canadian government, it's going to look this way. And if I'm building a website for the Canadian public, it's going to look totally different, right? It forces that reevaluation. It disambiguates. You say, you're going to have to choose who it is, the government or the people. And they fight it out, and eventually they arrive at a consensus. And how you get there, that's going to be up to you, right? One way is you give everybody some stickers, little dots, you know, those little dots that you can get? Give everybody five and say, okay, go up to the board and put them on and everybody gets to vote, five dots. Or you can just do it with a marker. Or you just ask them to gain, in a smaller group, just like ask them to gain consensus and you just write the numbers out. You're like, does that look right? No. So you're saying that the government's more important than, no. Okay. Let's try this. And so there's numbers of ways of getting there. And so it builds consensus. By the time you're done, everybody should be happy. But you're not done. You may be like emotionally exhausted and you need to stop the session and come back to it, but you can't be done until you're done. What is the cross product? We talked about it. It's when we take the project objectives, you building this website, and you multiply that by the users for each requirement. For each requirement, we find out what users does this requirement apply to, and what project objectives are being satisfied by this requirement. And you multiply that up in very, very simple math, and then you can just use that score to help you rank and determine budget and all that good stuff. So when to model, when do you do this? So preferably before the project scope is finalized, in an ideal world. We don't always have that opportunity. There's still tremendous value in doing this after. Here we are. When to model. Yes. When to step out for the washroom. So preferably before the scope is finalized. Preferably before the budget has been locked down. That would be ideal, right? Preferably before the RFP has ever been written, the client can get that clarity. If you've got the clout to be able to sell this before the project scope, first of all, congratulations, you've got big hairy ones. And second, you have got a phenomenal opportunity, A, to gain trust as an expert advisor to your client, to help generate the project scope, and to completely open up new possibilities that will hopefully turn into work for you. We are learning how to do that with the right kind of customer. You say, I've talked with you now for 2 hours on the phone, and I really still think that there's potential here that you're not addressing. Why don't you pay us a day rate? And you know, it's up to you to figure out what that is worth. You know, in our case, it's worth a couple $1,000s at least, something like that. But you know, you don't have to, and you can do it for free if you want, if you feel it's going to add value. Right, or it's going to help you make the sale, but you can do it anytime the scope is vague, or they need like just a minimum viable product. Do you do this for every customer? No, I don't think so, because it's time consuming. It requires like stakeholders, and it's a bit of a process. Whatever you can do, the more you can do this kind of stuff to get at some real scope, the better it is. Bottom line, right? The more you can do it, and the earlier, the better. This is what we're going to do. This is how the usage modeling workshop goes. First of all, as I mentioned, you have to have a facilitator. Preferably somebody that can get up in front of a crowd. So I'm obviously the wrong person for this job. Somebody that can energize the group, that can be dynamic, and that can think on their feet. And we'll talk about some tactics and some techniques for that. So the first thing you do then, after you get all the stakeholders together, is you define the project objectives. I used to do this in the wrong order, and it really, really makes a big difference if you define the project objectives first. A, it's the easiest thing for the customer to do. They already have the project objectives in their mind. So you can get them talking, and they're like, this is what we need to do, blah, 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 blah. And then you start pulling them into the dark side. You start quantifying, you start asking the stupid questions, and then they realize, oh, we're in for a ride, folks. And then you move on to the next step. And then you define your user groups. Once you've got those, then you have the wherewithal to identify the user scenarios. I will show you always quantify at every step. Always document, create your artifacts, and then analyze the results however you see fit. I'll show you one way, you come up with another, like that cross product. Take all of that stuff and document it, spit it back to the customer, turn it into all kinds of stuff. How many of you guys feel like you'd love to be a facilitator in this situation? A few of you. How many feel like this would be the scariest thing in the world? Yeah, okay, cool. Of those that thought this would be scary, how many of you talk to your customers on the phone? How many of you have had face-to-face meetings with your customers? Not too scary. This is like that, except that you're a rock star all of a sudden, because you are using a methodology that generates profound and exciting insights for the customer, and they will get excited about it and carry you along. So you need that courage to stand up in front of the room for a little while, and then all of a sudden that enthusiasm that just builds and the customer just pulls you along. So it's basically, think of it as meeting with benefits. It really is. As a facilitator, watch your timing. I keep looking at that clock because I'm trying to watch my timing. If I can hit 3 o'clock and start over there, golden. So watch your timings. Each of these steps should have a certain amount of time allocated to it. It's up to you to decide what that is, but try not to go beyond it, and just make sure you hit those targets, but make sure you get the work done. The worst thing that you can do is leave something unfinished and, like I said, hand it over to the client to complete. They never can, because they're not the facilitator. The facilitator's job, obviously, is to listen and to document, but to also add clarity. That's the hardest part of listening to a customer on the phone tells you, you know, this is what I want to do for my website. You're like, okay, all right, let me tell you what I just heard. So as a facilitator, you want to echo things back. You want to add clarity. You want to rephrase things in a way that removes all ambiguity, because 2 weeks from now, when you're looking at this document, you're going, what was that requirement? What did that mean again? I don't understand. You can't have that, because you're going to be now moving forward with this stuff. This is the record, the legacy of this this event, and you want to be able to you want to be able to write your proposal or your specs or whatever it is that comes out of this. You want to know exactly what it is. You don't want to forget anything. So add clarity, ask questions, and then document. And finally, maintain flow. Keep things going, keep people energized, take breaks if you need to, create that flow. This is the scariest part of being a facilitator, is like, well, we're gonna get stuck. We're gonna get to contributing, everybody's quiet, and it's like, oh, the energy just goes. So there's all kinds of stuff you can do, and I will show you these techniques, or I'll probably have to use these techniques, because this is gonna be a really odd crowd. For that, not that you guys are odd.
Yeah, you're odd.
But it's just an unusual scenario, right? It's not typical. So I'll need to use these techniques in a big way. We're going to need to take things and subdivide them, quantify them, find gaps, things that the customer may have missed, explore things deeper, ask stupid questions, bring in your own experience. Did you think about this? You know, I've done this for 3 other customers. Maybe you need to, oh yeah. Forgot about that. Take ideas upside down. What's one thing you really don't want on your website? That generates some interesting discussion. It's a really easy technique. And improvise, right? Just to try different things. And then know when to move on and know when to come back. So what are we going to do first? We're going to talk about project objectives. We're going to talk about user groups. We're going to inventory a bunch of user scenarios on the whiteboard. And then what you do from there, like today it's going to be kind of silly, but you would document and capture it. You would revise anything that you've, and then you would tabulate, calculate, do whatever you needed to create those results. And as we've mentioned, and sorry, I skipped a couple of slides. I'm going to come back to them. I'm going to keep them up on the board when I go over there. What can these results reveal? What's the payload? Why would you go through this process? What's really important? Where do you need to focus your energies? Where do you need to focus the client's energies in terms of writing content? Where do you need to get the team jazzed up? What are the real requirements versus the things that the customer thought they needed, or your team thought needed, or your CEO thought that she wanted? You know, what are those things that are the real requirements? That's what the numbers are going to bear out. we can, as you saw, we can come up with budget right there in a magical kind of formula, right? We certainly can come up with project scope. What do, what's going, what's in, what's out? And as you saw, we could even generate an RFP from this. We could literally generate RFP spec. So that's what we're hoping to achieve. So how are we gonna do this? So I'm gonna try to run a little simulation. I love ice cream. So we're gonna do something about ice cream. And so who better to ask, well, what the name of the company than my two boys, 3 and 5, Ben and Nick. And I'm like, okay, Ben, Benjamin. And he's a clown. So I'm like, Ben, what should we name this company that daddy's gonna talk? And he's like, poo poo caca. Right? And I'm like, okay, all right, I can't do that. And then he gets a sly look, he's like, call it butt boisters. I'm like, no, we don't use the word butt. Bum boisters? Like, no, no. So I'm like, okay, you're useless. Let me ask the 3-year-old. So like, hey, what should we call this company? He's like, daddy, can I tell you something funny? I'm like, yeah. Can I make you laugh? Yeah. Mumbies. I'm like, okay, this isn't going anywhere, so let's just call it Ben and Nick's Ice Cream Factory. You are all stakeholders in this company. Some of you are directors, some of you are operations managers, some of you are in marketing. You don't have to care who you are. It's just like, just imagine that you are part of this project to create a website for Ben and Nick's Ice Cream Factory. So it's not just an ice cream store. They actually manufacture really cool ice cream flavors. So their audience is quite broad, from the people that eat the ice cream to the people that sell the ice cream to, you know, all kinds of other people that we are going to discover next. Okay, so Ben and Nick Ice Cream Factory. The first thing we got to do is we have to define our project objective. So I'm the facilitator. You guys are the stakeholders. Take a minute, think about, you're creating a web, put yourself in the client's shoes. You're creating a website for the client. What are your project objectives? So let me just provide a bit of context. First of all, what's the difference between a project objective and a marketing objective? So if you ask any marketing organization, what's the number one reason we're building a website? They're gonna say, well, we gotta increase sales. That is useless to me. Yeah, okay, great. Is this website that we're creating, you know, is it to directly increase sales? What is the project objective? Well, we want to increase the number of people that are buying our ice cream, or we want to increase the awareness of our ice cream amongst the general public, or we need to increase sales in Ontario, or, you know, give me a little bit more that's relevant to this project. You've got organizational objectives. That's great. But how many of them touch the project? Question? It's both. In my imaginary scenario, this we have to satisfy. I want to keep it really broad. We could talk about all these different user groups. So it's a site that's going to do both. And then we can figure out, you know, do we create a customer portal? Well, let's find out. That's going to be driven by the project objectives and the end users. So, and we want to talk about strategies, not tactics. So you'll ask them and they'll say, we really want them to, one of the project objectives, they got to click that donate now button. We got to find a way to make them click that donate now button. I'm like, that's not a project, that's a tactic. And the objective is we want to increase donations. Do you see the difference? Like, don't let yourself get drawn into the weeds for functional requirements yet at all. That's the last step. Right now, we just want to talk about these, how would you measure the success of this project? How would you know that this project was successful? So, how would we know that a website for Ben and Nick's Ice Cream Factory would be, throw out some ideas. Megan.
We get more wholesale orders.
Perfect.
Really? Wholesale orders.
Orders, perfect, orders, I love it. Okay, good. That's rich, right? Because we have a word orders, it's gonna make us think of stuff. Wholesale, great. Okay, increase wholesale orders. Excellent. Beautiful. So, Fozzie gave me some really, really great ideas that are off topic. Okay, no offense, right? Because you were talking about user groups. So what I do now is I don't lose that because that's rich, that's value. So I'm going to go over here where I think I'm going to do user groups. I'm going to say, let's not forget diabetics.
Diet.
That's it. Goofs like me that regret eating ice cream but do anyway. What else? Anybody else?
Like allergies.
Excellent. Allergies. So this, my friends, this is getting me jazzed already. This is edge cases. This is stuff that could have been missed because marketing is not marketing to these people. But let's talk about them, right? Don't sweep that under the rug. Let's make sure that they're represented, and then we can deliberately kick them under the rug if we have to. But you know, that's let's expose everything. So beautiful. Okay, so other project objectives. How are we gonna know this project's successful? If we educate about what?
It could be what's unique about their specific ice cream product.
Okay, good. So facilitator job number two, take that and paraphrase it. Did I hear you say that you want to promote your key value proposition?
It's like filming Spider-Man.
So, these are the people that I've been working with for 6 months. So, you know, promote your key value proposition. So this is great, because then the next thing I'd say is, okay, well, what's your value proposition, right? And then we get into that discussion, and we probably document it, and who knows, additional objectives would come out of that. So remember when I said facilitator paraphrases and gets clarity? Facilitator also goes deeper. So now I'm going to say, so what is your key value proposition? And then you'll tell us, well, this is what we always have. We have the tagline that says, I don't know, whatever, the best ice cream in the world or whatever. And then we get into what does that mean? Okay, how else, we're going to know that this web project is successful if we
drive traffic to the retailers. So identify.
Beautiful. Yep. Absolutely. So, and we want to use a quantifiable increase, right? We want to increase customer we want to support retailer sales is really what we're doing, right? Is that what we're doing? What are we doing?
We're trying to get people into the stores and take product off shelves.
Okay, so
making it easy for them to identify their nearest storefront where the ice cream
brand
awareness. Okay.
No, it's not brand awareness.
That's a functional requirement.
Or retail. Yeah.
So it's, I think you're onto something. It's, we want to provide, in a general level, and we can, but we want to provide support to our retailers in some way, right? We want to help retailers increase traffic. We want to help them increase sales. We want to help people find their locations. We're going to provide support to retailers, right? This is a lovely, lovely requirement because all kinds of functional requirements are going to map to that. And that's critical to make this formula work. Okay, support our retailers. Wonderful. So, do you see what I did? I didn't just write down what you said. You guys don't even know each other and you're starting to talk. And we ended up with something really, really valuable. Really valuable here. I'm getting goosebumps. What else? This project will be successful if we'll... Perfect. Okay, so we could either take that and make it and split this. Another thing a facilitator does is subdivide. And we could say, support retailers, can we split that into multiple things? Or I could go deeper and say, so why do you want to support local markets? And we want to increase our sales across the entire organization. Why focus on local? And you might say, well, yeah, it's organic. We believe in the environment. And I'm like, oh, okay, so now we got this environment theme. Are you guys, you know, environmentally friendly? Yes, we're environmentally friendly, right? We support the 100-kilometer, you know, eat locally kind of thing, right? So we're supporting our local community. So now, and then we uncover, well, we have this initiative in our company to do that. It's a big priority. It's part of our charter and so forth. So we're like, okay, so what we really want to do is we want to educate people about our environmental stance, or we want to educate people about our corporate charter, or something along those lines, right? Like, help me phrase that. We're making this stuff up, so it's a little tough, but help me phrase what I'm trying to say. We want to
corporate responsibility, CSR.
Beautiful. Expose our corporate citizenship mandate. I like brand personality too, right? So we have to, that is a bit of a given, right? If you're doing good website design, then that's kind of a given. Forget it, put it up there, right? Because it, you know what? Get stuff up there. So promote and maintain our brand. Promote key value proposition, essential to that. I think they definitely come hand in hand. The what I would do here is I would have rephrased that to whatever that value proposition actually is, right? And maybe that value proposition is more around this, maybe it's more around that. So this is a little wishy-washy, I agree. But you know, with a real customer, we'd probably have put more meaningful there. Okay, I've got 5 points here. 5 is a good starting number, 8 is ideal, so let's try to pull out a few more, and it'll help us.
And increase orders, like outside seasonal areas,
by selling them. Nice. Excellent. The guy's a genius. Increase winter sales.
A cool accent, too.
Increase winter sales in Scotland. All right. Remain competitive in the market. Now, if I'm competitive in the market, you know what we're not talking about too much is, well, I guess if we support the retailers and we increase wholesale orders, that'll maintain our competitive stance in the marketplace. Anybody want to riff off of that? Work with that? I'm not feeling a really solid project objective yet, because that's very general, right? And how is this website going to help us to remain competitive? Clearly it will. By having a crappy website, that'll hurt us, and having a good website that's going to help us. But, you know, specifically, Lisa.
Your mindset is a competitor. Let's say there's a new brand on the market and you want to.
Excellent. Is that what our key value proposition was? What makes us different? Is that maybe what that is? Key value proposition, differentiator.
Or proposition.
Yeah, I think that's what that is. I think that's what that whole piece is all about. So that's good. I'm glad you brought it up, because this is an important concept, and it's good to document that. Let's do one more. Yeah.
Recruitment tool to get more people.
Why not? HR and recruitment. And by what I did was I broadened that just a little bit to help us catch a bit more requirements within that bucket. Okay, anything else?
Build list of product fans.
Tell me more about that.
So, users that normally have a relationship with the retailer, as the product owner, you have to go through retailer. If you build your own list of product fans, then you have direct contact to people who will be purchasing. If you like build a list of emails, so you can do promotions, right? So you can send out coupons. It's more.
I really, really like that. And the only reason I'm not jumping on the board right now is because I wonder if that's a tactic, if that's a sub.
Well, that's what I wasn't sure, yeah.
Right? And is it a tactic? Is it a way of doing something else? Is it a way of supporting our retailers? Is it a way of promoting our corporate brand? I don't know, but I really like it.
What about if we'll say, like, increase audience engagement or increase customer engagement?
Wonderful. Create a community, yeah, exactly. That customer engagement piece. So. Wonderful. You see what you guys have done here? Like, this is awesome. We don't even know this company, and we've come up with some pretty solid points. We have 8 project objectives here, and now, and we did that in 15 minutes. Rank them. That's my job as a facilitator, is to make you now rank them. Now, this is going to be almost impossible for uninvested people to sort of do. Which one of these is the most important? Which one's the most important? Anybody want to take a look and just sort of make a guess?
Getting dollars in the door.
Getting dollars in the door.
First one.
Increase the wholesale orders. Okay, so let's put. So what I do, this is my technique, and you'll have to choose your own. I start putting numbers up there. People are like, whoa, 50%, no. And they're like, but first, the question I usually get is, well, what does 50% mean? And I'm like, well, there's a number of ways of looking at this. It could mean if you had $10,000, right, you would be spending $5,000 on increasing wholesale orders, and everything else would have to share in the remaining $5,000 budget, right? And then I say, and then they go, whoa, $5,000. And then I say, well, okay, if your website project was $50,000, you know, which I hope it is, then you'll be spending $25,000 on increasing wholesale orders. And they'll be like, oh, okay, well, let's see what else happens, right? And so we start there. Okay. And so next, I'm liking this one as the next priority, right?
It
really relates. That sequences this, and one of you people is going to come up with a digital way of doing this where it just automatically resorts itself, and that's going to be cool. Or somebody's going to come up with these whiteboards that you can just do a minority report thing on. So, yeah, exactly, right? So 30%. So we're starting there. So, you know, that gives us not a lot left for all this other stuff. So. And then someone's going to be like, really? I got to split 20% over recruitment and customer engagement. Like, if we're going to create an online community, really? I'm going to have like that little money to do that? So that's not right. Let's rejig this. Did anybody get me? Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
So let's just, let's rejig that. Let's go with 30 and 20 for now. So that gives us 50% more to work with. So that's feeling reasonable. And then we go to what's next. This is probably lower. This is almost always lower. This is kind of a tactic, really, but I like to keep it on there because it is unique. It's a great idea. Promote our corporate brand. That's going to support all of these activities. So now let's put 15% there. So that we're at 65%, right? Okay. Corporate citizenship, key value proposition, promote our differentiator. Like that one. So let's, between these two. So now we get to, so this is where we're getting into the nitty gritty, right? Okay, so between those two, the value proposition, like the differentiator, or our corporate citizenship, what do you think we should? We don't know. We don't want to know at this point. We don't want to know yet. Well, see, this exercise tries to be as agnostic as possible because we may decide that we need to get those other people using the site. Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't want to, I never ask a customer for their Google Analytics. I don't care who's using your site to change all that. We can launch a marketing campaign to get different people if that's what we need to meet these objectives. So, between these two.
Well, unless your corporate citizenship mandate is your key value proposition, then the key value proposition supports the others, but the citizenship mandate does not.
So you're suggesting that the key value prop is more important than the corporate citizen. Yeah. Excellent. Unless they are one and the same, which, you know, may be the case, but probably isn't. This is probably a subset of that. This would be a, you know, a word, carefully chosen word in that statement. Okay, so good. So then we can't use the same number twice. That's one of my rules. We cannot put a fifth in there. So it's either going to be 14, and I hate arithmetic. Like, as soon as I get off of the fives, and I already start having trouble with five. So I'm like, okay. So I'm putting 10, and we can't use the same number, so I'm putting 5. And, you know, we're getting into some pretty fractional numbers down here. So, you know, and we look at that, and And that's a great rule because, you know, you start to force yourself to ask those questions. So that means that, okay, who's good at math? 50?
80. You're at 80.
We're at, thank you. Are we? We are. Okay. We have 10% left. So how is that? Okay, winter sales, HR, customer engagement. I'd probably want to put this up there.
Yeah.
Right? So, is it a 5? Is it a 10?
A 9.
It's a 10, right? So but we're going to put 10 as a placeholder. And then I'm going to ask you two important questions. I'm going to say, is this more important than that? And I'm going to say, which one of these two is more important, right? So you think this is more important than that?
Yes.
So, okay, so that's still the right number. This is this more important than that? Or is this more important?
No.
Customer engagement is less important?
Yes.
Okay. Everybody agree?
Yeah.
We have consensus? So we'll throw a 7 in there.
Which,
an 8?
9.
9? Okay. All right, well, we'll put an 8. Give ourselves a little wiggle room if we have to. Okay, 12. We got 12. So then what I do is I just go 6 and 6. How does that feel to you guys? And you're like, which?
If you put a 9 and an 8,
7 and 5.
No.
7. We can't do 7 and, okay, good. So 7 and 5. So is HR more important than this? No, right?
Nope.
So this is 6. Now, aren't you glad I didn't use 9? 6 and 4? Okay, so now, okay, we got that. Let's validate. So now we validate. And this is the most important. This is next. Is our promoting our corporate brand important than promoting our value proposition? I think so.
Yeah.
I think so, because the brand kind of encompasses the value prop to a certain degree. So that one validates to me. Corporate citizenship versus customer engagement. Do we think of that customer community, that customer portal, that engagement with customers as more important than talking about our local programs and our environmentalism?
We're going to go to trade shows. We need to have customer engagement this year.
Okay. Megan said it.
Yep.
VP of marketing said it.
Yes.
Done.
Promotion.
Are we happy? Do we have consensus on this? Yeah. Give ourselves a round of applause. That was freaking awesome. Anybody jazzed about this stuff?
Super pumped.
Right?
Yeah.
This is cool, right? This is really, really cool stuff. And it's simple. Can you guys do that? Could you do that in a meeting with a customer? Not yet? We'll get you there. Yeah.
I was terrified, originally, when you talked about. I'm less terrified. Looking at this, thinking, at what point do you make certain judgments? Because three of those items on there are really about grant.
Mm-hmm.
And so then they end up getting a huge amount of weighting. Other things are getting small. So do you come back and sort of re-examine that at some point?
Absolutely. And you know who does that? The person that you are representing right now and the customer. Whoever that person is, there's always somebody that's either the voice of reason or the accountant or whoever you've brought to the table. Someone's going to say, whoa, 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 this doesn't feel right to me. And then you're going to open it all up again. You're not going to erase those numbers. You're going to say, well, what do you think? And then someone goes, yeah, you're right. So that is really, really powerful, and thank you so much for bringing that up. It's like, this is a huge weighting. And so what that shows is that this process is iterative. We're not going to get it right. I'm pulling numbers out of my head, right, for lack of a better term. And that's, you know, that's the kind of stuff that this generates. So it's really, really powerful stuff. Good. This is going to make your life better because I'm going to switch over to here. So we have our business objectives. So now we're going to move on to look at who are our user groups. Yeah.
Like, let's say people on their special day, like wedding day, want to Christmas or baby shower. And I think the tactic is we can shape the ice cream. Like, if it is baby shower, we can create like a baby ice cream.
You're a creative type, aren't you? You're a designer, aren't you? Is that right? Very creative. Be thinking of solutions, right? You're already going all the way down, even past the user stories, down to how could we actually solve these problems. And that is what that's where we draw the line. Like, we don't go that far yet, right? So, but I want to capture what you talked about. So you're talking about life events. So I'm going to put that in the parking lot. And this is going to be called life events. I want to remember that. So I'm parking that here. It doesn't actually, it's not a user. You're talking about users at various events, but it's not, doesn't describe the user himself or herself yet. So it's not, can't go on this list, but it's something that's definitely worth capturing because I could definitely see a whole bunch of user stories coming up around that. Okay. Yes, you are, but you fall under like the consumer as that's sort of your user group is because it's a user group, right? We don't need to break it down unless you have a real category of ice cream that is, you know, whatever. Like let's say we do birthday cakes as one of our offerings, then we definitely have to have, you know, people that are having birthdays or event planners or whatever, right? That could be a specific user group. So you know, let's put event planner as a user group. Let's see if that sticks. That's a good kind of user, right? But at the end of the day, you know, I think, you know, we obviously are going to put the consumer in here, right? And so then the next question I would say is, can that be subdivided? Do we have different kinds of consumer? And you're sort of suggesting a course of action where we have daughters and, but then I say, well, is daughter really a user group? Because is that a meaningful, distinct, atomic person that we would market to? Daughters. You imagine on the website, you know, daughters, click here. And I'm not sure, right? Do you know what I mean? Like, so that's how.
Mother's Day, click here, not daughters.
Sure, Mother's Day, and so that's in a life event. We want to take that into account. But talking about user groups at this point, we want to just imagine that you have this, you know, websites where you have logins, and you know, if you're a customer, click here, that kind of thing. So we're just trying to imagine, but to validate this, we're just trying to imagine that we had a website and, you know, on the website you come and it says, are you a consumer or are you a wholesale? And then you click on one and you get one, and the other you get another, like that. Not that we do that necessarily, but we have to envision that. So I just said wholesale, we should probably put that down.
Hospitals.
Why do I not know how to spell wholesale? Here we go. We're selling holes. All right. Okay.
Internal marketing.
Thank you. Let's be an advocate for the internal users. Who else? Let's get some edge users. Excellent, excellent. Yeah, we've gone down this route before with other customers, and I ended up in different places. Because sometimes we say, this is retailer, right? Wholesale is actually retailer.
What about institutional customers like a hospital?
Okay, let's just capture that real quick. Who?
Competitors.
We always put that down. Okay, so just hold on to your awesome ideas. I want to just, what was it, the thought that I wanted to continue with? We have retailers that we're talking about potential,
yes.
Right?
Current, existing versus.
Okay, so that sounds like a split. So we do a split here. We say, all right, let's just experiment with this. Potential thing. Is there another category? So as a facilitator, I dig deeper. I ask, I say new. Is there?
Based on diet, so vegan or dairy.
Okay. Okay, so we'll do, that's probably a consumer diet split. And I'm just gonna come back to this real quick. Do we split this into three? Do we do potential retailers, existing retailers, and new retailers? And the only reason I bring that up is because I could see a bunch of user scenarios that are specific to people that have just signed on and they need the info package and they need our logo and they need to book training and stuff like that. I think so, because potential, I'm trying to sell you on why you would be a retailer. I mean, it could be. We could split that. We could stick that up in there, potential and new.
Retargeted.
Or we could put existing and new, because they are exist. If they're new, then they already are customers, so they're a retailer, so they're existing. And then the numbers are going to decide whether we merge it again or not, and how we merge it. So that's. We don't have to answer everything yet. We capture it, and then we come back and validate it, and then we merge it. Yeah. Cool. And is that, that's not consumer, that's retailers, right?
It's both, but it's lost customers of any kind.
Former customers.
Yeah. Do we want to split? Do we want to do that for both of these guys, or do we want to do it just for retailers? Okay. So we're calling that retarget.
Retreads.
Lost. Okay. Good. Definitely from a customer portal, I can see that making a difference. Also from our sales initiative. I'm thinking, you know, let's reframe this in terms of the website. Would you ever have a button that says small retailers, big retailers? Not that you'd use that language, but would you ever get them to self-identify?
Different types of guests, right? So the amount of support and stuff they would get as well, what comes along with that level of support.
And is that something that would manifest itself on the website, or would that be more of the, you know, my support team would be handling you differently, and in the back end it might be different? I feel like it doesn't necessarily make its way to the website, my gut feeling. And then, you know, we'd have that discussion as a customer because we don't know what the answer is here. Okay, so I wrote some acronyms down, or some abbreviations here. Institutions, right?
Yeah. Prisons, hospitals.
That's what I like about you, Conrad, thinking about those edge cases. And what was the...
Competition.
We always try to put it down.
Customer service
representative. Our customer service representative? And that's not the same thing as marketing, right? So internal.
Even if you had a live chat and somebody was asking a question, they'd have to look it up.
You bet. Love it. Internal support. CSR. Very good. Job seekers. I always send that out there. Job seekers, right? That's definitely a user group. Exactly. And then when we start to run out of ideas, so this is the add to your toolkit, right? We get to keep the flow. You guys have been great, and I haven't had to pull up my toolkit yet too much. But if we run out of ideas, then I go, let's go over here for a second. Let's go back. This is why you do this first. That's the insight that I realized after doing it a couple times. Come back here so that we can find some more of this stuff. So we say, all right, look, increase wholesale orders. Obviously, we've got that covered here. We've got retailers. That's cool. Is there any user groups here? We just talked about HR. That's where this came from. Anything else in here that we haven't?
Investors.
Ooh. We've done this before. Investors. Excellent. And so in the interest of time, we'll just sort of wrap that part up. This you don't want to be exhaustive. This one you want to kind of limit to 5 to 8. This one needs to be exhaustive. Right? We have to consider everyone, because at some point we're going to come back and we're going to do something like 0% or whatever, right? We're going to say, no, you know what, they're out, but I want to have documented that. We're going to decide, you know what, we don't give a crap. They can do what they want. You know, and in some cases, you do want to think about the competition. We had a scenario where one customer had union employees, and all of a sudden, union became an agent in there. And, you know, that was something like, whoa, never thought of that before. Didn't see that one coming. And we had to sort of figure out, how do we handle that? So I'm going to ask, I sort of glossed over this, but let's come right back to this. So we talked about diet, I think. I put consumer diet. There it is. Thank you. So is that how we want to subdivide our consumers? How do we want to subdivide our consumers? That's a broad audience. We should probably try to subdivide that. Do we want to do it by these kind of groups? Or do we want to just lump that under special needs?
You maybe lump it under product that you sell. So there might be products that are categorized by dietary needs, section, they have an all fruit section, they have a yogurt line, which caters, it's based on the needs of the consumer and what they're looking for.
Mm-hmm. So thinking of the website and thinking about the windy path and the different ways that people are going to engage with the website, think about the consumer. Got a consumer with a special dietary requirement or allergic issues. We definitely need to provide something on the site for them, right? Clearly, like they're going to want to do some research on our product. So, do we split consumer Or do we just gonna have a create a special category of user for that? Exactly.
So if you want to category and sub-segment off of that category, or for the purposes of today, just have the category.
Well, and I'll get to you in a sec, Conrad. The objective of, we have to remember that we're not yet at this part where we're thinking that we're, because I heard some crazy ideas and really good ideas about, that are starting to think about this stuff. We're still just stuck a little bit in the trap of thinking too far down the line.
So it goes back to whoever the business owner is should know what segments they're selling to. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So at that point, whoever the business owner is, say, yeah, we're going to go after WordCamp Toronto Swirl after, you know, this group of people.
Yeah.
But we're not going to do Drupal people because they're not as
cool.
Bright.
Exactly. And you're not wrong. You're not wrong. Okay, so I'm going to definitely put, you know, dietary restrictions, or I don't want to put special needs over implication, but let's just put dietary restrictions.
This information comes under compliance. This is a food service. They are required to provide the nutritional information about
mm-hmm.
the product.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
it's not relevant to a consumer. It's a compliance issue.
So this is, you've just brought up a new...
No, government regulations, what do you have to put in?
Yeah, exactly. So you're talking about, so you've identified a user group that's like the government or the regulators or whatever. Well, I'm going to put regulator up here, right? Somebody that's checking me out, checking out our website, making sure that we comply. You've mentioned Ali, right? So we want to definitely get Ali in there. 100%. A11Y, accessibility.
It's a user experience when I get to the website.
Really? Already? Darn.
It's a user experience when I get to the website. I would like to see the drop down diabetes and I need to click and
yeah.
see all products.
Exactly.
I don't want to read all.
No, precisely. Exactly.
But
one last.
Consumer, kids. I'm thinking specifically of Menchie's, for example.
You bet. Who isn't thinking of Menchie's? I've been thinking about Menchie's since I started this talk. I'm going to Menchie's right after this talk. But kids, right, beautiful, thank you. So kids, how could we have forgotten? And then we could even say kids / parents if we wanted to. And that would come, you know, from the customer.
But would that be under consumer?
Yeah, it would probably be under consumer, you're right. Okay, so, and I don't need to do the number split again because that's going to take time that we don't have. 100%. You have to quantify every single time. But in the interest of having a few minutes left, let's pretend that we've gone through that. We've beaten each other up. We've come up with numbers for all of these. We've crossed a couple off our list. We, you know what? And this is not big enough of a deal. They can always contact our regulatory department and we'll provide them with that stuff. You know, whatever, right? I'm just suggesting that we would whittle this down a little bit. And now we start to talk about user stories, right? And I want to do, I want to run a few with you. And sometimes these come right away. Like I just start saying, okay, take any user that you can think of and let's describe one thing that they want to do. One thing, right? Or if we get stuck, then I say, well, let's take kids. What's one thing that kids want to do?
They want to look at
flavors. Okay, so perfect. Okay, good. So you have described a functional requirement in that last statement, which I would then retranslate. So you said they want to look at pictures. And I'm like, that's in a way, it's a bit of a means to an end. I think you're right. They do want to look at pictures. But I would refer to that more general, so I don't have to use pictures. Because what if it's video? What if it's something, a drawing? What if it's interactive? So let's... Boom! Okay, so experience, we always use an action word up front. Experience a representation of the full product line. How's that? Beautiful. Okay, good. So that's one thing that kids want to do. And then I would say, what is another thing that kids want to do on the website?
French language.
Okay, so again, consume content in French and English. Excellent. Play games. Okay, so let's stop thinking. Go down there. Let's think about retailers. What is order product? Beautiful. Order product. What else? Retailers.
Wholesale discount.
Continue with that. Learn about incentives?
Yeah.
Are they going to be the same for every customer, for every retailer? Existing or new or potential? It would be. So I wouldn't put down, I wouldn't say review my incentives. I would say maybe review or learn about our incentive program, right? And that sort of covers that, right? So, okay, learn about incentive. Order product, review order history.
Tom,
yes?
Just along the lines of what you just did there, prompting.
Yeah.
Because this should really come from them, do you tend to prompt as you go along if there's something that you think should be there?
Totally. Totally. Your insights are as valuable as anyone else at the table. And your responsibility as a facilitator is to document every piece of insight that comes to you. So if it came from your own brain, spit it out. Don't cut anyone off, cut something down if you have to. But you know, everybody adds insight because you are, remember, let's go back to why the facilitator is important. You're bringing a unique perspective, just like everybody else that's sitting at that table. It's cross-functional. So your insights are extraordinarily valuable because you're coming from a different place altogether. So if you didn't come up with it, and then you're active, right? So you're going to forget things. And so you have to just get it out as quickly as you can and just document, document, document.
So as a facilitator and your company, do you also have another person, sort of like a court reporter?
Thank you. I forgot to mention, it really helps to have an ally, right? And or to someone to play off of this. Someone does the business objective. Someone does the, like, if, you know, me and my business partner often do that. We play off each other, and it gives you a bit of a break too, right?
And then
the more note takers you can have, right, on your team, absolutely. The more you can document stuff from different angles, the better, right? So it's good practice. Okay, so in the interest of time, let's just sort of look at this. So what I do now, so this is, we're almost done. We're almost done the process. I have lost my red marker for some bizarre reason. What the heck did I do with my red marker? It's in my pocket. That's what the heck I did with my red marker. There it is. So now we do a mapping. 5 minutes left. Okay. So the question that I now ask is, let's go back to here. Which of these, we let them. First of all, we resequence them. And so we go A, B, C, D. Oh, geez, E, thank you, F, G, and H, and then we go, whatever these are, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so on, so on, so on. Use letters and numbers, and now I say, okay, let's get some letters up here for experience the visual representation of the full product line. Who does that appeal to? Give me, what corporate objective does that address? It's going to increase wholesale orders. What else? E, which is create customer engagement. Very good. Support the retailers. For sure it is. 100%. CCC, promote our corporate brand. You got it. We'll leave that one out. Increase winter sales? Sure, why not? Right? And so we do that. And we do that for all of them. And you can decide, I usually do this, and then I come back and I do the next one. But for in this case, let's just go back, and we say, all right, now, which of our audience segments, which of our user groups, does this particular line item address? Who does this? Visual representation of the full product line. So, kids, right? Kids, event planner probably, wholesale for sure, accessibility, which is a really interesting one, all of a sudden, right? Whoa, that's powerful, right? And suddenly the news, some whole bunch of requirements come out, like, what if you're blind? What do we do about that? Let's describe our products, right? Let's make sure that, you know, so that's really, really cool, it comes out of that. These guys, we had sales internal support for sure. Investors, not really. Institutions, yep. So all of a sudden, this has got a ton of audience people after it. You know, and it's got a ton of, this is going to be a huge percentage, right? A huge one. Let's go do this one. Okay, so what business objective does that address? I actually, now I'm remembering it, I actually do this first and that. I flip the order when we're doing this. So I would actually say, okay, play games, who's that all about? And it's going to be only two, right? We're going to go, oh, that's only these guys. Okay, all right, I know where this is going. And which of our, you know, that's going to be our C, corporate brand, probably, customer engagement.
Mostly E.
Maybe F, right? And so all of a sudden, these guys have a totally different weighting. And E and F, and this is just, or sorry, down here. And the last, and this is where the bomb explodes in your brain. Because not only is it arithmetic, it's the cross product. So E is 8%. And F is 7%. So, you know, this total weighting has to be taken into account, right? So this is 15%, 0.15, right? And then this is, and how this, like kids is going to be high, right? One, kids is going to be really high. So this is like, you know, whatever, we're going to say this is 50%, right? Whatever, just for argument's sake. And so that is going to be 0.5. And then you do that multiplication, and you get a number. Somebody has a calculator, want to give me that number? Not that it matters, whatever. And this is now your, right? You take that and you figure out what they're worth. You take this and each one of what they're worth, you add them up, and now you multiply that by that, you get a score, boom. You sort in Excel and you're done. And I'm done, so. Cool? Cool.